Hello, today we are meeting Irina Cesar from Moscow. She's a researcher on different fields, also on the field of Slavic languages. Hello, Irina.
Hi.
Okay, let's start from some basic introduction about yourself. So tell me in a few sentences your history. Maybe you can do it.
Okay, I will try. My name is Irina Cesar, in Russian. I am 53 years old and have three children, grown-up children. I'm a president of the company Wave Genome and CEO of the other company, Matrix City. What I'm doing is trying to stop genetic collapse with my companies and bring forward the quantum leap. And I consider the situation to be very serious. So if we would not bring forward the quantum leap, we will get literally the destruction of genomes on this planet. Planet genome, animal genome, human genome. So my business activities are not simply, money-making in a regular capitalist sense. And I would not ever do just simply money-making. It's not interesting to me. So for me, it is a kind of fight for the survival of my people and survival of humankind. And I clearly see the seriousness of the situation, and I clearly see that if I would not do it, it will be harder for people to survive. And I have three children, and for me it's also the survival of my three children. And I also do art, and do art professionally. And was the most famous philosopher, Anglo-American philosopher of art, Arthur Dante. And before he died in 2010, he was asked about who would be the rising star of art. So to whom he would point his finger, and he pointed the finger to me. So I would say that my career as an artist is quite successful, and I am represented by the Natalia and Tatiana Kolodziej Art Foundation, and they exhibit me in the big every year in some big American museum, and I was exhibited in Tretiakov Gallery. It is the major art gallery of Russia. And in the United States, in the Chelsea Art Museum and other museums, and my art and art collections all over the world. Also, I do philosophy, and I do global geopolitical analysis. And I am published by the large journal in India, called Socialist Factor, London and Lucknow based. And I tried to do it in Russia, but in Russia it was basically, it was blocked. So as soon as I organized the information agency, Kazakh TV, it was blocked for a few months. And it was blocked not by Russians, it was blocked through the territory of European Union from the territory of Holland, Netherlands. So they have their artificial intellect, a huge mega computer who is basically doing censorship on their global internet. So this is the idea of the Royal House of Netherlands, to do internet censorship. So they are already doing it. And they're doing it by Mobitel. It's a company which is a Trojan horse in the national network infrastructure. So, for example, Rostelecom, it's a Russian company, right? 49% belongs to Russians, so they don't own the control package, and but they own the infrastructure, and 13% belongs to Mobitel. And if you look to it, Malaysia and other countries, the same thing. So this group of bankers who own the central banks of the world and who wants global domination, they right now they're building cyber empire, and they put Trojan horses inside national infrastructures. So this Mobitel is a Trojan horse, and it is doing censorship of Russian internet through the territory of the Netherlands. And then I wrote an article about how Israel shut down the plane, Russian passenger plane over Sinai, which was going to St. Petersburg, by their laser weapon, Iron Beam. And the next day I published this article. My co-founder of the agency was hit by Mossad agent, and they literally threatened him. So this was the end, because he was afraid for his life. So this was the end of my junior, like, expert career in Russia. So now I'm published by Indians. They publish me every month, and radical articles, very radical. It's so radical that the last issue and their site is not accessible anymore in Russia. So I tried to actually access their site in Russia. Today I was not able to access their site in Russia, socialistfactor.com.
Okay, now the manipulators of the world want to mix different races, especially in Europe. So how would you describe the future of this kind of politics?
This is a very famous idea of the founder of the European Union, to create the race, the mixed race in Europe, which is similar to the ancient Egyptian race. So it's Semitic race, because Egypt is a Hemet, meaning half white, half black. And for them, this is basically the expression of their radical racism. So these are people who cover themselves as Semites, though they're not Semites. They're Khazars, and Levites are R1A1, so they're identical to Russians. But any criticism of their criminal activities, they try to argue against, accusing their criticizer as anti-Semitic. So they're not Semites, you see, and they are racist.
Just like someone noticed that the biggest anti-Semites are the Israelis, because they kill the Palestinians, and Palestinians obviously are Arabs, Arabic people, which are Semitic, but Israelis are not Semitic, so it's one big lie.
Well, they're partially Semitic, you know, partially, very, very little, yes, like 8% of them are Semitic, yes, Mizrahim and Sephardic, they're Semitic, yes.
Okay, so let's go back to the history. Let's start with the history of Slavic people and, Hyperborea, this kind of, this big continent on the north. How was it in the past?
Mm-hmm. Well, let us start with the word Slavic. We are not Slavic. There is no such thing as Slavic. This is the diversion and the lie. In the 17th century, Romanov Koshkin, future Roman emperors, they changed our historical records. manuscripts, so-called letterpiece. They have rewritten our historical records, manuscripts, literally rewritten. And they changed the name of our people. The name of our people, if you look at the sources, you know, ancient sources, was Slavic, not Slavic, Sklavic, Sklavic, Sklovian, Skalot, and we called ourselves Sak. So Sak as Anglo-Saks and German Saxons and Russian Sak are the same people. So we're not Slav as slave. You see, British English word slave, we are Sak, the same people. And the goal was basically to split the Sak nation into compartments and, make them enemies. And such enemies that we became Slav, slaves, and they became Saxons, you see? But in reality, we are Saxons also. We are Sak. So in every ancient manuscript, right, and medieval manuscript, we were called Sklovenia. Right now, this truth is so dangerous, you see, to the people manipulators. You see this 13 Hazar bankers, you see, because this truth endangers their call for global domination. You see, they're very afraid that we again get united in one nation. That's why they hide. Let me just finish. They hide this truth. And if you look at the records, you will only find that we were called Sklavine, but it's not true. We were called Sklavene, Skalote, and we called ourselves also Sak. And Sak is derived from the word Sokol, Sokol, falcon. So we were falcon tribe. And the symbol was falcon, fiery bird, firebird, phoenix, Phineas Yasta Sokol in Russian legends, okay? And this falcon, Sokol, that's why we were called Sak, because it's the abbreviation from Sokol. And the emblem symbol was Sokol, falcon, right? And this falcon was called Rarok. And Rarok is derived from Ra, for light. That's why we are yelling, Ra! You see, because Ra is light. And our river, Volga, was called Ra in ancient times. You see? So, in other words, Ra and Rosh and Rus, Ruski, you see? Rus is the same thing. It's light, Svetly, you see? Light. And in other words, Sokol and Ruski, Russian, is the same thing. So every Sak, every Anglo-Sax, and every German Saxon is Russian. Because Sokol was called Rarok, Svetly, light, you see? And in the 38th chapter of the book of Ezekiel, in the Old Testament Tanakh, it is said that in the north there is the country Rosh, which is more ancient, more civilized, and more technologically advanced than Judea, and where from the fiery chariot comes. So the fiery chariot, Vimana, in the book of Ezekiel, always comes from the north. So there is country Rosh on the river Ra. You see, light. You see, where the most ancient civilization on this planet is located. And this civilization is called Rosh, Russia, on the river Ra, of the fiery falcons, Sak. You see, so everybody, we are not Slavs. You see, we are Polish people, you see, Bulgarians, and Hungarians, and Slovenians, right? Czechoslovenians, Yugoslavians, Horvats, all of them, you see? All of them are Sak. We are all Sak. We are not Slavs. There is no such thing as Slav. This is the biggest diversion, the biggest lie that actually split us into pieces, you see? And made us weak. and made us inferior and made us forget our origins. And you see, our origins are in Russia. We all lived in Russia because there was the war. 17,000, some say 17,000 or some say 14,000 BC, there was a global war. It is historically, archaeologically, geologically very provable, easy to prove. Okay, there was found nuclear waste. You see, all these deserts are remnants of the nuclear war. There was the war between brothers, not between reptilians or aliens and humans. There was the war between us, between our brothers. You see, Russian Aryan brothers. And the war was a high technological war. Plasma, laser weapon, nuclear and gravitational bomb war. And it changed the gravitational field of this planet. And megalithic cities all over the planet were destroyed by this war. And you can see at this on this megaliths the signs of the laser weapons, you know, like scratches like this, you see? You can see plasma weapon signs, you see, because some stones are molten, you see, some stones, the same stones are not nearby, you see. You can see megalithic blocks in a kind of brick structure, half molten, and they lost their shape, but you can still see that it was the building, you see. And then you can see stones put one on above another. Because these were people, were giants, and for them, you see, these were not megaliths, they were regular small stones, right? And they built graves on the place of the cities, and they put stone upon the stone, right? And people were giants, you see, there was completely different gravitational field. This gravitational field was destroyed by the gravitational bomb. And people went under the ground, you see, after this war. And they were under the ground for a few thousand years. And they got out approximately 10,000 BC, you see, Stone Age. So they got out of this underground cities, you see. And when this war happened, the axis of the Earth moved, you see. And the entire Europe was under ice. And this ice covered Europe almost down to the very south of Europe. So England, Scandinavia, Poland, Germany, you see, even North Italy was under ice, you see, and half of Russia, but east of Russia was not under ice. And the climate zone was not horizontal, it was vertical, so closer to Urals was warmer. And 7000 BC, there was the interglacial period when the temperature in the polar areas of Russia were not lower than the winter temperature in Greece right now. So it was relatively warm. And this is when our ancestors rebuild the civilization. And the civilization was rebuilt by matriarchs, because historically we know that matriarchy was before patriarchy. So women rebuilt civilization. And why they did it in the north? Because our planet is not a sphere, it is an egg, because of the torsion effect. And Aina sphere has the dome shape over the North Pole. And this dome shape, a kind of Kozarev mirror dome, creates a specific objective causes for super intelligent life. That is why birds from all over the planet go to the north to hatch, to lay their eggs. You see, because in the north, they know instinctively there are conditions for better life, for better, you know, nestling, for better offspring. And because this dome, right, has the shape of has such a shape, right, that every signal gets reflected upon itself, and we get diffraction grating, which refracts every next signal towards the zero center of the wave crystal. And through this zero center, you can get to the noosphere and to the other dimension, you see? So that's why the North Pole is a natural teleportation portal. It's the most precious location on this planet. And that is why birds are flying there, you see? You see? So it's very, very well known in Russia, because Russia has huge territory, you see, in polar areas. And there was the expedition of Bachchenko in the beginning of the 20th century. He was a researcher, and he was sent by communists in the 1920s to the polar areas of Russia. And he found out that the time and space is different there, and people are different there. And he researched the phenomenon of so-called Merechenye, when the entire villages are going into trance collectively, and you can observe the radical increase of the psychic abilities. You see telepathy and all kinds of clear vision. So evidently, these areas near North Pole, they have these qualities objectively, you see? The existence of two souls in the same body, etc. And the same researcher, Bachchenko, he researched the shape of our ancestral helmets. And helmets have the same dome kind of structure, right? And he found out that these helmets increase the psychic abilities of humans. So our ancestors who used these helmets, they actually were using telepathic abilities on the battlefield, you see? So they actually communicated between each other telepathically. And our ancestors, they used this shape, dome shape, everywhere, you see? They lived in Yurta, you know this, when they built houses, but when they were going around with their cattle, they were building yurta. You see, the dome kind
yeah.
of structure.
Like in Mongolia.
We brought it in Mongolia. It's our. You see, it's our legacy. You see, even the bowls. You see, even the bowls that we eat from. You see, the bells that we ring. You see, every time when pandemic was in Europe and pandemic was approaching Russia, Russians were ringing the bells. And the bells were literally stopping waveforms of bacteria and viruses because of this quality of reflecting every signal upon itself, you see? And when the signal is reflected upon itself, it neutralizes itself, because the wave is going right like this, then it is gets reflected upon itself, and the peak of the forward-going wave is neutralized by the trough of the same wave when it is reflected upon itself.
Yeah,
this is called this
standing
is
wave.
The standing on scalar wave. Yes, you can call it zero wave. Then when it call it zero wave, you understand this essence actually of this wave. So this is why the origin of civilization on this planet is literally the North Pole. So even if there is the ice over the North Pole, every soul comes into this dimension through the zero point center of the torus of the crystal of our planet, but it goes out, you see, literally to the surface through the North Pole. So it's a portal, you see. So that's why you see Hyperborean. It's literally meaning Nordic from the north, from north. And it's also actually meaning the super fighter. You see, this is what people don't understand. They think that Hyperborean is simply Nordic. It's not simply Nordic. Hyper is huge, great, and Borean is бороться, fight. You see, great fighter. So great fighter from the north. This is what it is. And Vedas preserved this knowledge. In Vedas, It is said that the gods came to India, in the sun, not from the skies, from the heavens. They came from the north. And Indra has yellow hair, you see, the god Indra has yellow hair. And Brahman, when he marries, he asks his bride, dear, do you see the north star, the polar star? And she is supposed to answer yes, though the polar star, the north pole star, is not visible in India. It's visible only very low on the horizon. So they remember, you see, that they came from the north. And they signed the marriage certificate on the bark of the tree. Берестяная грамота in Russian, right? This, you know, this writings on the bark of the tree. So they preserved this knowledge, this memory, you see, that they came from the north. And in the far north of Russia, on the Kola Peninsula, it's a very far north. You see, we have three rivers, Aryan, Sura, and Ala. You see, no Iranian, Indian, or Semitic person reached the Kola Peninsula, you see? And the entire territory of Russia is covered with rivers Aryan, Sura, and Ala, because L and R were interchangeable, you see? And the ancient name was Ra, you see? But then with the change from matriarchy to patriarchy, the writing changed its direction from right to left to the direction from left to right. And Ra became R. And our ancestors, they tried to preserve the most important words. So Ara, it's actually Ara or Allah. So Allah is our Russian word, which means light, Aya or Iri, you see? The same as Ra. So matriarchs, they brought the cult of Ra to Egypt and to Indostan. You see? They reached Thailand. I was in Thailand, in Bangkok, in July. So I saw the Thai culture and I saw Buddhist temples. And Buddhist temples in Thailand look like very specific huts from Vologda. It's a very far north of Russia. You see? These are logs, you see? So in Thailand, they don't build from logs, you see? So the huts from logs, you see, very high. You can see this huts only in Vologda. You understand what I mean, right?
Yes.
They built high huts from logs, you see, and they have very characteristic two-headed horses. It's a skiz. It's our tradition. Or every Russian hut had, especially in the north, it had this two-headed horse on the top. Конёк, called конёк, from horse, конёк, конь, horse, you see? So you can see this horse, two-headed horse, exactly the same in Thailand. And I bought even, I can even show you, right now I'm not prepared, but I have it. I have exactly the same artifact, approximately 3000 BC, you see, from bronze, which I bought near Moscow. This because it's very characteristic. It's a very thin stick, and on this stick you have two-headed horse. You see, and near Moscow, in the area of the region of Oka River, we have 30 rivers identical to rivers in Mahabharata. Okay. So if you have rivers on Mahabharata around Moscow, you cannot argue anything against it, okay? And also we have the embroideries in Vologda, swastika embroideries, you see, like this. Exactly the same as in India. And we have this matriarchs standing like this, you see? They're standing like this. It's a rajanitsa, the woman giving birth, right? In the far north, exactly the same as in Indostan, and they are much more sophisticated than in Indostan, you see. And we have this two-headed bird. So it's not eagle. Russian symbol is not eagle, it's falcon. You see? And we have this falcon in the far north of Russia with breasts and womb. And in womb we have a little baby, a girl standing also like this, or a flower. You see? So evidently, you see, evidently it's our symbol and it's not eagle. You see, it's falcon. And why falcon? Because women, they tamed animals. They tamed cow, pigs, horses, elephants, you see, geese and sheep and cow. They even tamed lion because you can see Durga, you see, goddess in India riding the lion. So evidently they tried to tame lion too, you see. So they tamed falcon, they didn't tame eagle. They were success in taming falcon. So it is falcon, you see. It is two-headed falcon. And falcon was important for them because falcon rises to the sun. You see, every time they were looking at the sun, they were seeing falcon. You see, falcon was in their mind firebird, which brings souls from their absolute light, because we don't come from Orion, we come from Arya, from the absolute light. You see, that doesn't have time and space, borders and end and beginning, it's infinite, eternal. And souls are coming from Arya, no, Ra, not from any kind of planet, you see. Woman brings the souls here. That's why she is a firebird. So firebird was a woman, and this woman owned this dimension. You see, they considered this their own dimension. You see, and from the point of view of a mother, you see, it's not racist or nationalistic, and they considered every animal, every plant, every human being or not human being to be their offspring. You see, like baby, like children, their children. It was matriarchal way of thinking, you see. That's why they have this Christianity, right? So it's actually was not created with Christ. If you look at the records of Egyptian records, because matriarchy was in Egypt, it was ruled by matriarchs, and the head of the pantheon of gods was Mat, literally a Russian word Mat. Right now it's transliterated Mat, it's not Mat, it's Mat, and it was depicted as fiery falconess, you see. And because this falconess owned the world, it was depicted as griffin. Or Sphinx. It has wings of a falcon, body of a cow with breasts, paws of a lion, and a tail as a snake. So I wear, see this thing? See? Griffon, griffon. So this is not even a two-headed falcon. Russia has a symbol. It's a two-headed sphinx, two-headed griffon. Female, by the way. It's a female griffon, which is the combination of these four animals. Every animal stands for this one specific part of the world: north, south, east, and west. Global empire. So it has nothing to do with nationalism or racism. They were not racist or national or Nazi, you see. So this kind of matriarchal consciousness, right, way of thinking, is completely opposite, you see, to any kind of nationalism or racism, you see. And they were giving wives. They even married Neanderthals. Because when they came to India, they met these people who degenerated after the global war. Hanuman. You see, Hanuman is depicted as half man, half monkey. His lower jaw is monkey jaw. And Hanuman has a wife. And wife is a very white, you see, woman from the north. So they gave women to Neanderthals. Gilgamesh, which is more ancient than Tanakh, Old Testament. describes the same situation. You see, Gilgamesh is the king of Uruk. Uruk is the same as Arak. You see? So Ra, light, right, was the kind of water of light, of life. Water. Water and light was together. That's why Ra was light and Ra was also river, Ra. The same thing is Arak. Arak, Uruk, and the falcon, fiery falcon of Etruscans was also called Arak. So he was the king of Uruk. Uruk is Ar, literally Ar, it's Aryan city. And he had a friend Enkidu, who was Neanderthal. And he gave him a woman, you see. In this way he civilized him. And when Enkidu died, and why Enkidu died, we took him on Vimana. And his nails and hair fell out from radiation, probably. So after his friend Enkidu died, Gilgamesh went to the north and crossed the sea. So he went from ancient Iraq north, crossed the sea, so it was an Aral, probably sea, Aryan sea. So he went to the territory of Russia to meet with gods and the mortal man Utnapishtim, who survived the global flood. So he went to the territory of Russia to meet with gods, who were the gods of ancient Sumer, you see? So this is the other ancient source, you see, globally recognized, you see, which proves that Russia on the river Ra was more ancient than Judea and then Sumer, you see. And he himself was two-third god, meaning that he was two-third Russian, you see. So this means that the territory of Russia is described by the epos of Gilgamesh as the territory more ancient than the territory of Sumerian culture. And it describes the territory of Russia as the territory where the gods of Sumer lived. And they described Russians as the gods of Sumer. So it is supporting the idea that Gromagnons, who never were Neanderthals, you see, these were people who survived the last global war. They never degenerated to the stage of Neanderthals. They remained human, you see, and they preserved the remnants of this quantum leap civilization, which was much more advanced than present-day civilization. So this civilization survived on the territory of Russia, in Russian culture. And it survived specifically in the polar areas, you see? And the point with this epos of Gilgamesh is that one of the major points is that it is not the Sumer, it's the other lie. It was not Sumer. You see, we call it in Russia Shumer. It's not Shumer or Sumer, as the Ibichev say. It's a Sumerian culture, Samara. It's not Sumer. This is the lie of Freemasons, of Knights Templar. So this is the lie of the Western academic science. Very vulgar, very base lie. Basically to put down the civilization of this area and disconnect it from the global civilization. Because matriarchal civilization was global civilization, you see? So there was already global rule on this planet. And it was matriarchal rule, it was Russian-Aryan rule, okay? So the city that stands in the epicenter of the so-called Sumer, it's called Samara. It's the Iraqi ancient city of Samara. And if Gilgamesh says that Gilgamesh went to the north, to the territory of Russia, to meet with gods, right? This means that these gods lived in the Russian city of Samara. So this means that Russian city of Samara is more ancient than this Iraqi city of Samara. You see, we have city of Samara and we have two rivers of Samara. One is to the right of River Ra, Volga. And another one is to the left of River Ra, Volga. So one is on the territory of Urals, It starts in Urals and then it goes into River Ra, Volga. And another one is on the territory of Ukraine. And Somma, River Somma in France, also was called Samara in ancient times. And Samara literally means Samara. In Russian, literally, it means itself Ra. And according to the expertise of Durga Prasad Shastri, who is the most famous Indian Sanskritologist, Russian is the most archaic form of Sanskrit. And according to the expertise of Svetlana Zharnikova, who is, he died a year ago, she was a researcher of Indian, ancient Indian and ancient Russian connections. According to her expertise, in Vologda, they speak the slang, which is almost 100% identical to Sanskrit. So Sanskrit is actually Russian language, you see? And Russian is the most archaic form of the most archaic language on this planet. And if you look at ancient Hebrew, for example, right? Paleo-Hebrew, it's written with Russian Aryan runes. So, Paleo-Hebrew, runic language is identical to Russian runes, German runes, Anglo-Saxon runes. So, it's a runic language. And swastika was a letter in this language. And it designated unity, all unity. And it designated sun as all unity. And at the same time, it designated man. And it was called either man or van. So, Ivan, Vanya. And sun is the same thing. So man was sun, man sun, and it was called Vanya. So Vanya is man sun. So it's this global human, superhuman. So this is the major. This is the major proofs. These are the major proofs. And if you look at all this. Ancient civilizations, the most ancient civilizations mostly preserve matriarchal culture. So in Egypt, the major goddess is Mat, depicted as white woman, as a fiery falconess with wings. And she brings this fiery, small birds, fiery falcons, souls from Arya, light. And if you look at India, you see, in Indistan, you see that they call gods Devi. Devi. Deva is a virgin in Russia. Deva is a plural from Deva. And they call teachers Baba. And Baba is a woman in Russia, matriarch, you see.
Yes.
So, and there are temples there, Ravinath. You see, so Ravi, Jesus Christ was called Ravi. You see, in Gospels. So Ravi is from this temple Ravinath, is a complete swastika temple to Shiva. Shiva is Sva. Siva, Shiva is in Hindi and Siva is in Sanskrit. So Siva is Sva. Sva is Svet, light. And the second name of Shiva, Siva, is Makosh. Makesh. And Makosh is a major goddess in Russia, matriarch, okay? So you can evidently see the remnants of this first Aryan, Russian Aryan wave that, you know, came to India, which was much earlier than the Aryan patriarchal wave, which came to India approximately 2000 BC, you know, 1500 BC. So they came to Indostan matriarchs approximately, I would say, 7,000-8,000 BC. So they got out of the ground, underground cities, 10,000 BC, and then they, you know, restored the civilization in during the interglacial period, 7,000 BC. And when it became colder in the north of Russia, they just came down in all directions. At the same time, they came to North America, and you can see their remnants there. You see, every ancient grave in America, it's actually a Russian grave. It's white people, blonde, blue-eyed. Some of them even preserve the iris, you know, blue iris, you see? So you can see the same with the pharaohs in Egypt. They also have very Nordic faces, like grandfather and grandmother of Tutankhamun. They have completely Nordic faces, and they have wigs with bright, very bright yellow hair to stress that they were actually white people from the north.
Okay, and we also have Triglav, the god, Slavic god, and Trimurti in India.
Yes, yes, yes. It's completely, yes, completely the same thing, yes. Mm-hmm. And this culture, Tripolia, you see, Tripolia in Kostyonki in Russia. The archaeological layer is uninterrupted, and officially it's already recognized 25,000. But it's more, it's older. It's some say 46,000, but it goes 70,000 uninterrupted swastika culture. So Cro-Magnons, they emerged not in Africa, they emerged in Russia. They actually didn't emerge, they just got preserved from this last global war. You see, they went under the ground, but then when they got out to the surface, some of them were not able to preserve their minds, you see? And it depends also on the objective conditions of the environment, because closer to the equator, it is harder to preserve intellect, you see? Because torsions of our planet, one from the South Pole, another one from the North Pole, they get neutralized at the equator. So it's literally very hard to preserve your sanity there, you see? So that's why people are literally degenerated in that area. So they degenerated to the stage of Neanderthals. So the development was not from Neanderthal to Cro-Magnon. The development was from the giants, antediluvian giants, right? Who were highly developed human beings, who were capable of controlling environment via their psychic abilities. Because we read Vedas, you see, we read in Vedas exactly that they were able to control environment with the strength of their mind, you see. It's written in our ancient manuscript, Vedas, okay? So it's written there. So they were capable of changing the physical qualities of objects and phenomena. So these people, they degenerated to the stage of Neanderthals after the global war, you see? And then this Russian matriarch, Babe and Deve, right? Babe, Deve, so women, this was spreading, literally bringing the civil people up, those who degenerated, because there were no such things in before the global war. There were not such things as nations, you see, in our sense, or races. No such thing. You see, you read Vedas, there is no such thing. You see, so they merged after the global war, and they say that researchers. In linguistics, they say that it is enough, 1 century is enough for a new language to develop, you see? So you can get a new language, like right now in Ukraine, new language, new nation, just over the night, you see? You can create new people, you see? But in reality, they are us. So Polish people are us, and Ukrainians are... They're not even Slavs. There is no such thing as Slavs, you see? So in a sense, everybody living on this planet are Russian. You see, if you look at Ethiopians, right? Language of Ethiopians, they were true Jews. So if you want to see true Jews, they are living in Ethiopia. Tribe of Judah or tribe of Seth. Because synagogue is a Greek word. Tetragrammaton is the Greek word. Pentateuch is a Greek word. You see, synedrion is the Greek word. So the only Bet HaKnesset, you see, it's in Hebrew. And it means the house of the great king Set. So the tribe of Set. Set is a Negroid god of the Negroid tribe of Set or Judah in North Sudan and Ethiopia. So this is true Hebrews, you know, Negroid Hebrews. And if you look at the alphabet is identical to Russian alphabet. If you look, take Coptic alphabet and Russian alphabet, identical. Have cha, sha, sha letters. Nowhere, in no alphabet, other alphabet, there are cha, sha, sha. So the alphabet is completely identical, you see? So this means that we gave them this alphabet and they pray to swastikas, you see? And if you look at the language Gaes, which is a more complicated language than classical Hebrew, right? It is the language in which all authentic Hebrew manuscripts are written, right? This Gaes is actually the language which accommodates runic and our language, Scythian, you see, Russian. I call it Russian Aryan Scythian Sak language, you see? So it's literally our culture. And the ancient, the most ancient city of Israel is called Skifopol, Pol, at the end. The most ancient cities in Egypt are Aleopol, erroneously called Heliopolis, and Heracleopol, erroneously called Heracleopolis, you see? Because Greeks added H, G, you see, at the beginning of our words, which is not a letter, is an apostrophe, a comma, you see? So it is Heracleopol, is the suffix. Aleopol, Aleopol is the city of Allah, light. So we in Russia have name Allah, it's still very popular. Allah means light, Arya, Ara, Allah is the same thing. So Allah, Russian Allah, it was before Allah Elohim and Allah. So Elohim and Allah of patriarchal culture are much more later than Allah in Russian. So Allah or Allat, you know, the Syrian goddess Allat, which is falconess, fiery falconess, right? So it's more ancient than Elohim and Allah. And Allat is the same thing as Elada and Lada. Lada is a Russian goddess, you see? So, and the very city Jerusalem is called by locals Uruz Alim. So Uruz is Russian because this is how all southern people call Russians. They call them Uruz. And Alim is a teacher. So it's a city of a Russian teacher. Uruz Alim. Volkhva. So, and Allah, you know, Ra, the river Ra, is also called Volga, and Volga is the variation of Valgala. So, Volga and Valgala is the same thing. And Volga, Valgala means Vala, Ga. Ga is the road, V means into Allah, into light. And we have another support, textual support, besides Gilgamesh, and Tanakh, Old Testament, we have the support by Old Edda. It is Scandinavian epos. And in Old Edda, it is said that Swedish people, Swedes, they were living on the territory of Russia, above the Aral Sea, in Great Sweden, Great Svitjot. And Svitjot is from the Russian word Svet, light. And then they went to the north, you see, and founded the small Svitjot, small Sweden. So in other words, it says directly, you see, that Vikings, you see, they lived on the territory of Russia and spoke Russian, you see. And if you look at the funerary speech of the 17th century, Karl the Great, the Swedish king, it's literally written in Latin letters, but Russian language. So everything, like literally everything is Russian. So all every word is not Latinized, it's a Russian language. You see, unmistakably Russian language.
And also the word Germania, Germans, are people from behind mountains. Gurman. Gura hora.
Germans is Gehe is a prefix which was added in Hellenism. Greeks added it. In reality, it's not Germans, it's Ariman. Araman. Man is man, and Ara is the Aryan. You see? So it's Arimane or Alimane. Alimane or Arimane. You see the same thing, Aliman or Ariman. So they are Armenians, you see? So real Germans or real Armenians are these Aryan, white, very white, blue-eyed, blonde people. And on the territory of present-day Turkey in Anatolia, there is the ancient capital of Ahriman, Germans, called Ani. And there are temples there, dome temples, you see? And there are frescoes there, still preserved. And these frescoes, they depict very white, blue-eyed, blonde people, you see? So these are ancient Germans, you see? And the name of the city is Ani because Anunnaki, you see this Anunnaki, they were not evil reptilians who were trying to enslave locals. Anunnaki were women. You see? Ani. It's derived from Russian word Ana for she. So that's why the capital of Anunnaki was called Ani. Ani. So Ana. Ana is Ana. Ana, she. She, so Anunnaki were a matriarchs, Devi, Babi, and they did not enslave locals. You see, this is bullshit that Zakharia Sitchin created out of nowhere. You see, they literally, in Iraq, they literally brought these Neanderthals up. And if you look at the Gilgamesh epos, it doesn't describe slavery. There are no slaves. You see? These people were happy people. They were had temples, and temples had virgins, the most beautiful girls of the tribe. And every man could have come to this temple, have sex with a virgin every day. It was normal. So it was nothing wrong with that. So no slavery, no caste system, you see. So the king of Uruk, Gilgamesh, he took a friend, Neanderthal, from the woods. Who looked like an animal, dirty, could not speak. You can imagine, right? Dirty hair. He was. Ooh. He took the king, took a guy from the ditch. You see, washed him, give him clothes, give him a woman, and made him friend. Him his friend. So no caste system, no slavery. So this bullshit of Zakharia Sitchin is completely total violation of historical truth. So these women were very compassionate because they survived the global war and they remembered, you see, the horror of this war. This horror, the memory of the horror made them compassionate, you see. So they were compassionate. They were worrisome, yes, they created iron and bronze weapons. That's why they were basically with this, sabers and swords. And samurais are also from Samara in Japan, the same culture, swastika culture. But they were very compassionate, and even now we're able to unite this territory only because of the compassion, not because of colonization. You see?
Okay, let's go back to the word Slavs and Slavic. You see, there are three in Poland. We consider like three words which are explained as the origin of the word Slavic people. One is the disinformation, which says that Slavic people come from slaves, obvious disinformation. And another explanation is that Slavic comes from słowo, word, but also from sławny, famous, because when you speak a lot of words about someone, this someone becomes sławny, famous. And because the Romans could not conquer Slavic people became famous. And Slavic people were not slaves of the Romans. It's this information. In Praga and in Volin Island were the biggest trade markets of slaves in Europe. So it's not true that Slavic people were slaves. Slavic people traded slaves to Romans and to other people. So the word Slavic comes from Sława and Słowo.
Mm-hmm. This is, you see, this is the late interpretation. There, it's no point to argue, you see. You simply go to Google, right? And you put Sklavini, Sklavini. And you see, you can see that in all sources, right? Literary sources, historical manuscripts, everywhere. You see, we will call Sklavini, okay? Sklavini, not Slavini, it's later, you see? So in other words, our name is Sklavini. Okay, so it's not nothing with Slava, it's Slovo. It's all later, you see? So, it, nothing to argue about. It's all, it's just historical truth, you see? So if you dig, you see, patiently, and you read more, and you have time to read, and you go through sources, you just see that it's nothing to argue about. It's just a fact, historical fact. And if you have Sklavina, then you need to understand why it's Sklavina, you see? This is the mystery, you see? Because I was the first, basically in this scholarship, I was the only one who said that Sklavina is derived from Sokol. You see? You see? It's very important to understand why.
Okay, another thing. You said that...
And you know why it is important to understand? Because this culture, civilization of the fiery falcon was brought by us to every part of the planet. If you go to Middle East, right? Syria, Yemen, Egypt, Iraq, Iran, right? It's all symbol. What is the symbol? Fiery falcon. You go to America, these Indians, you see, with these feathers, Africa, the same thing. So it's very important to understand that we, matriarchs, fiery falconesses, brought the culture of fiery falcon, fiery bird, firebird, to every continent. And it was we, Russian Baba, Baba, I'm Baba, proud Baba, Russian Baba, you see?
Super. Okay, another thing. You said that all the Slavic people and others also come from Russia. And our haplogroup is R1A1. But when you look at the map of density of this haplogroup, there are two places on the world with the density 50% or more. One is Poland, 50%, and one is Afghanistan, Turkmenistan, this part of the area. In Russian you have 35 or something percent. So it looks like it was the other way around. It's from this Turkmenistan, Afghanistan they came, somewhere also from above China, I don't remember, Urdu or something, and from Poland, where it's also mostly one haplogroup. So Russia is much more mixtured, diversified than other Slavic nations.
You know, this is disinformation. Russian is actually a very pure, genetically very pure, mixture. And the percentage of R1A1 is very high. But you see, the point is that I, for example, I don't identify Russians as R1A1. I consider that this is one of the another lies and divisions. And this division right now is right now he softened his position, but he was moving forward this position very rigorously. Professor of Harvard University Anatoly Klusov, of Russian origin. So he was saying that Russians are R1A1, okay? And R1B1, okay? R1B1 are Turks. Turkic. Turkey in Russian. Turks, you see? So we have, in Russia, we have a lot of R1A1, but then we have a lot of R1B1, okay? Then we have N and C. Couple groups, okay. So, and it goes like half of Russia, big pieces of Russia, a lot of R1B1, okay. So, who are they, okay, right now? Who are they? So, he says they're Turks, you see, and they create this phantom of Great Turan. So, half of Russia becomes Great Turan, though Etruscans called themselves Turanians. And in a Western language, which is a kind of Sanskrit, Turan means To-Aryan. To means this, Aryan, right? Turan is To-Aryan, and this falcon, right? Arak, Etruscan, was also called Turan, meaning To-Aryan, from Arya. To-Aryan, this Aryan, right? So it is evidently not anything else different from R1A1. And in Siberia we have historically, right, so we have R1 haplogroup, not R1A1 or R1B1. We have a haplogroup R1. It's more ancient than R1A1 and R1B1, you see. And historically the territory of Poland was covered by ice, you see. So, in other words, after the global war, everybody lived on the territory of Russia. And it is the territory to the east. No, you see, polar areas to the east of the ice. You see, because ice was covering like European part of Russia, not the eastern part of Russia. So, this is in the polar areas. You see, they preserved and restored the civilization. Then they came down to the Siberia, basically. So Siberia and Urals were not covered with the ice. And these megalithic cities, right, were always surrounded by Bronze, Neolithic, Paleolithic, Neolithic, Mesolithic, and Bronze Age settlements of our ancestors. You see, they always put the Bronze Age settlements near the megalithic cities, you see. So R1, this is the our haplogroup. So this division into R1A1, R1B1 is the same strategy, you see, to divide our people, you see, and clash them together in fight, make them enemies, you see. Because we, after the global war, our women, matriarchs, they went south in all directions, you see. So they went, and when they went in all directions, evidently, their haplogroups got variations, you see. So got variations. So in other words, the whole discourse, haplogroup discourse, is very, I would say, historically, right, and scientifically incorrect. So the whole thing is not important, you see. Most important is the common origin and common goal. And variations and uniqueness is fine only if you understand that the origin is the same, and the origin is all unity. So we come from all unity, and if we go back to all unity, if we are not capable of grasping the concept of all unity, then we reincarnate as animals, monkeys, you see? And all unity exists by individuality. I formulated the implication of the holographic principle in 2012, which says that if the universe is entirely in its every matrix point, it's a holographic principle, right? The universe is entirely in its every matrix point, then every matrix point is not simply different from any other matrix point, but is unique. So in other words, unity exists by individuation. So the more you are individuated, the more you united with other individuals, you see? So there can be unity if there is no individuation. That's why it's normal that Polish people are a little bit different. You know, there's Velikorossi, Belarusi, Tatari, Bashkiri, all nations. We have 144 nations on the territory of Russia. And we never killed any of them. So Anglo-Saxons, they killed 140 million Mongoloids on the territory of America, which had very heavy load of Russian blood, by the way, R1A1, variation. So evidently our brothers, right? So they killed like the whole continent full of people, right? So we never killed any. They preserved their language, variations of languages, slangs, and everything. And it's fine, but it's fine only if they remember that they actually brothers and sisters, and our ancestors, they encouraged international marriages, and this tradition, custom, to cut the veins, you see? So they were coming to other land, they were cutting the veins, and they were putting hand like this to mix the blood, saying, we are brothers, you and me, the same blood, you see? This was our tradition. So we were not afraid of mixing the blood. So all this, you know, all this talk about preserving purity of blood for our ancestors did not matter. You see? They did not try to preserve a specific make of, you know, blue-eyed and blonde. They did not care about it. My mother was a Ukrainian Kazakh, from the ancient Kazakh family. Black hair, black brows, you see, olive kind of skin, you see, dark skin. But she was Aryan, you see, she was absolutely Aryan, like Aryan, Southern Aryan, you see, branch. So, it's okay. So, some are blue-eyed, some... You know, my father was blue-eyed, my mother was green-eyed, but black hair, black brows.
Okay, in today's world, it looks like there is this one or more controlling groups which want to distort everything. And Slavic people look like being on one side, and the manipulators, they kind of are on the other side. So how would you describe who is the opposition, if any, of the Slavic people?
Well, I wouldn't call Slavic. I completely abandoned
okay,
this term.
This word.
Russia, just call Russian Aryan or Scythian Sak.
Okay.
Because we need, you see, the point is that if we are looking for truth, we need to be truthful. So there is no such thing as Slavic. So say Russian Aryan or Scythian Sak. Or say Sklovian, Sklavik, say. If you want Slavic, say Sklavik.
Okay, Sklavik, yeah.
Slavic, Falcon tribe.
Okay, so who is the opposition of this Slavic people?
Neanderthals. Always were Neanderthals and always will be, because this planet is a playing ground. It will always be like this. There will be no progress here. By the way, there is no progress anyways, because the universe is simultaneously existing in all an infinite number of dimensions. So in this on this planet, we have the coexistence of infinite number of historical epochs, historical periods. So some people, nations here, are living right now in Stone Age. And some people are living in quantum leap age. And this will be like this always here. It's like a playing ground to become here from Arya to verify whether we still have light bright and we can come back. Or if we don't have our light bright, then we reincarnate as monkeys, as animals. And Neanderthals are those who did not pass the test. So they will reincarnate as monkeys in the next reincarnation. So reincarnation is real. And the point with every person is that every person has its own history. So some person is actually rising. You see, so he was he was maybe an animal in the previous life. And he is rising up. He is a young soul, right? And others are straight from Arya, who came here to fight. So everyone has its own history. There is no one global uniform history. You see, everyone has his own story. And we fight here with Neanderthals. Those who committed karmic crimes, and that's why they will not be even reborn as humans. They can't be reborn as humans.
Okay, so is there any relationship between those Neanderthals and reptilians?
Excuse me?
Is there any relationship between those Neanderthals and reptilians?
There is no reptilians. This is another lie and bullshit. There is no reptilians, you see? The reptilian story was created by Zionists in order to alienate from us our history. Because a matriarch here depicted this great goddess, right? Matriarch, the major matriarch, as griffon. And this griffon was consisting of four animals, right? Falcon, right? Cow, lion and snake, and mostly it was the combination of snake and bird, Garuda, for example, right? The bird of Thailand, the falcon of Thailand, is at the same time snake and falcon. And if you look at lion of China, it's not lion, it's a griffon, you see? And dragon of China, it's not dragon, it's a griffon. You see, it's our Russian Aryan, we brought it there. It's our Russian Aryan griffon. And if you go to China, you see these dragons, these swastikas, and you see this Celtic, you know, this, they call it Celtic patterns. It's like this, interwoven, you see? And you see the same thing in Russian, in Russia. It's Celtic, it's Russian, actually, Russian Aryan, you see? Rurik dynasty, Falcon dynasty, because Rarok and Rurik, we have Rurik dynasty, right? Skitha and Sak dynasty.
Yes, yes.
So they have on their tombs in Kostroma, in Ipatievsky monastery. There are tombs completely devastated. So they don't this Romanov dynasty, Vatican spies, in British spies, they destroyed, tried to eliminate everything about Rurik dynasty. So these tombs, they have these patterns, you see? This so-called Celtic, you see patterns. You see the same patterns in China. So we brought Chinese dragon is our symbol. We brought it there, you see? To Japan and China.
Okay, so if there are no reptilians, so who does those blood rituals?
Mm-hmm. So, and this mother, right, mother, Vasilisk, in our legends, Russian legends, the major heroine is called Vasilisa. So So Vasilisk, right? This dragon, right? Vasilisk, right? Or Basileus with the emperor, the same thing, you see? And she was depicted as a woman whose arms are snakes, whose legs are snakes, and even whose dress consists of snakes. Also, she was depicted as female face, Sun. Sun was Ra, it was a woman, Rama. Ra is Sun, Ma is mother. As a woman face, female face with the hair as snakes. You see, Gorgona. So, Gorgona is Gehe is a Greek prefix, apostrophe. In reality, it's Argona or Arcona. So, Arcana or Intaro, you see this card, Arcana, is Arcona, Argana, Yarga, Swastika, Sun. You see? So, those people who commit human sacrifice are Neanderthals. It has nothing to do with the with anything, you see, with the initiation, mystery, knowledge, illumination, these are simply Neanderthals. And mostly, they right now, they're criminals and so-called Illuminati, right? I call them Illuminati from Berdichev. Berdichev was a provincial, or is a provincial city in present-day Ukraine, and in Russian Empire, those people who commit human sacrifice and are engaged in pedophilia, they were not allowed to live in the empire. So they were allowed to live only beyond the area of settlement, you see, on the outskirts, in the outskirts of the empire. So Berdichev was the city where the scumbags, you see, were gathering, you see, were gathered, you see, the criminals. Because we were forbidding human sacrifice for millennia and we didn't have slavery, you see? Romans, they allowed slavery, but they were forbidding human sacrifice. And they were distinguishing between nations who are civilized and nations who are not civilized by the criteria whether this nation commits human sacrifice, you see? So they destroyed the second temple of Solomon in Jerusalem in 70 AD. Because the Jews desecrated the land to such a degree by blood sacrifice of humans that Romans destroyed the temple. They put salt, you see, on the land so that nothing would grow there, you see. Because, you know why for Romans? Because, you see, they remembered that they're coming from Arya. So this memory, they still preserved because Romans, to us, Roman Empire, it's called Slavic Empire. So for you, not so Slavic, Scythian Empire, Russian Empire, because 20 emperors, Vasilisk, Basileus, were Scythians, Russian Aryans, you see, 20. And their capital was called, the city is still called Constantinople, Istanbul, right? So it's not called Constantinopolis. So Greeks added suffix is, you see? It was called Constantinople, meaning that Greeks were later guests there. But the city was built by Scythians, Sak, Russian Aryans. And the city was identical, Constantinople, to such cities as Tiraspol, Nikopol, Petropol, Neapol, you see, Acropol, Simferopol, Sevastopol, so the city of Polania. So our ancestors, we also, in some period of time, were called Polania because they were bringing agriculture everywhere they were coming, you see? That's why they were calling their settlements Pol. So Greek city is called Polis, but they cannot explain the etymology. Of this word. Why polis? Polis because it was polia. Polia is the agricultural field. That's why our ancient culture was called Tripolia. And Tripoli is the same as Tripoli in Lebanon and Tripoli in Libya in Africa. Because we brought this culture of agriculture to Middle East and Africa. And why Tripoli? Because we had three fields. One was under grains, Another one was under grass for cattle, and the third field was resting. It was all those three fields, you see? So people, they don't even understand why Constantinople. Because it's pole, you see? And there are Zelenopolia, which is green pole, green fields, Stavropolia, Межполия, you see? So the culture of Polania, Polania. And poles, by the way, are Polania, you see? Poles and Polia and this culture is the same thing. So absolutely the same culture, the same civilization.
Okay, so let's switch now the topics. Let's talk about scalar waves. There is a short film on YouTube with a German doctor who discovered a method of communication via scalar waves, not normal electromagnetic waves. And then he was arrested and they shut him down. But this kind of communication exists. It's secret kind of communication. And also it is used for attacking people. Some people say that they are being attacked by different waves. So please tell me, what do you know about scalar waves besides what we said before as a standing wave? But scalar waves are something more complicated than just standing waves. So what do you know about it?
Well, scalar wave is a standing wave, you see? The point with the scalar wave that it does not actually transmit anything. You see, it doesn't transmit information, it does not create any energy, you see? There is this guy Palladino, you see, he says that scalar wave creates some light effect over his camera. So if he says that scalar wave creates some light over his camera, this means that he doesn't understand what scalar wave is. Because scalar wave is a zero wave. It neutralizes, as I said, any signal. Because it reflects the signal upon itself. And when the signal is reflected upon itself, the peak of the forward going wave is neutralized or nullified by the truth of the same wave when it is reflected upon itself. So the point of this scalar wave is that it creates the diffraction grating, which reflects any next signal, external signal, towards the zero center of the wave crystal. So diffraction grating creates a wave crystal with refraction mechanism, you see? So if you have two wave crystals with exact refraction mechanism created by scalar wave, you can transmit information instantaneously from one geometrical code, you see, which is holography, you see, based upon the laws of geometrical optics, you see. Some specific refraction mechanism of the geometric code of the wave, okay? So if you have exact geometrical codes of the scalar waves within the wave crystals, right, you can transmit information instantaneously from one geometrical code to the other geometrical code. In 1970s, in the Center for Astronautics near Moscow, there was an experiment conducted when the pregnant rabbit. Yeah, was put in one convex lens, copper lens, and the goat, pregnant goat, was put in the other convex copper lens. And these convex copper lenses were exactly calibrated. They were exact, you see, geometrically. And that's it. They were just put in the two lenses, you see. And because the lenses were calibrated the same in the same way, right? They created the same the same wave matrix, you see, which is non-local, because every matrix, wave matrix is non-local. Every wave crystal is non-local, you see. So if you calibrate them exactly, they are the same, basically. It doesn't matter even if they are in the different time and in the different space. So you can actually control future and control the past. If you get the exactly calibrated geometrical codes, okay? Right?
Mm-hmm.
It's very powerful, right? So so you can transmit information instantaneously, independently of time and space, even independently of morphological differences between species, right? So you can use this geometrical code as the carrier holographic signal to transmit, you see, donor information upon the recipient. You see? Or actually just override the morphological information. So this was done. It's actually proven by the experiment that it's possible. You see?
Yeah, I know that this is used also in this technology for traveling by different civilizations who travel through portals in the outer space, even when they go back to the past or in the future, they go to different galaxies, they can always instantaneously communicate with each other using these scalar waves.
It's not scalar waves per se, you see?
Okay, using this technology. But my question is, how do you do this tuning, resonance, for communication? You need to have two identical devices, or how?
Well, there are two ways, two processes, you see, different processes, you see? First process, when you transmit information between exact copies of the same non-local unique wave matrix, wave crystal. In 2012, I formulated the implication of the holographic principle. Holographic principle states that the universe is entirely in its every matrix point. And I formulated the implication. And the implication states that the universe is entirely in its every matrix point. This means that every matrix point is not simply different from any other matrix point, but is unique. It's a priori truth, okay? Self-evident truth, analytical truth, okay? Because quantum physics is an analytical science. It's not empirical science, because you cannot empirically experience infinity. It's impossible. Time and space infinity, you can have empirical experience. So if you have two copies, exact copies of the same non-local, unique wave matrix, you can transmit information instantaneously, independently of time and space. You see? Because every matrix is unique, right? And it's non-local. So if you have two or many copies, right, of the same non-local wave matrix, right, you can transmit information because the all copies constitute one and the same non-local wave matrix, right? For example, animals, right, animals, they are viruses or bacteria, they're not single organisms, you see? They are, every species is a planetary organism. This is what they are. Biology, you know, conventional biology doesn't understand. So every bird, an insect, is a part of the planetary organism. And if birds of the specific species, they understand something. For example, the summer will be cold. Every bird right? We'll understand these species, they share information instantaneously, right?
Yeah, just like the rule of the 100 monkeys.
Yes, and monkeys, they were taught on the island, in the ocean, some knowledge, and the other monkeys on the other island, separated by the ocean, they got the same knowledge.
Yeah, the same way we have this like upgrading of human consciousness nowadays. If the mass of people, certain mass of people, raises their consciousness, the others also have this effect.
Yeah, but humans are different. They are not animals. You see. Humans are not part of the planetary organism. Humans are individual, you see? So species, animal species, has the access to noosphere, but every individual, right, specimen of the species does not have, you see? Only the species as a whole. But the humans, they are different. Every human has access to noosphere. You see, every human is individual, unique, non-local wave matrix. So, for example, you, right? We can take laser, which is capable of creating a holographic signal. Because in the universe, everything is holographic. And you can transmit and record information only by the device which is capable of recording, you see, and transmitting, creating holographic signal, you see? And if everything is holographic, you can transmit and record only holographic information, you see? So we use lasers, which have mirrors inside. And these lasers are capable of changing the linear signal into holographic signal to record your hologram, right? So we can record your hologram from your photograph, let's say, right? Childhood photograph, and digitize it. And then we can create a copy, exact copy of your hologram. And then we can transmit the information from one copy to the other copy instantaneously. This is one transmission, right? Between the exact copies of the same non-local unique wave matrix or hologram, right? And because the matrices or holograms are individual, unique, right? There is a certain barrier between them, right? They are protected from each other. You see, each one exists in its own infinite universe. You see, each one of us has the infinite universe. You see, each one of us is God, basically, with his or her own universe, right? So there is a certain barrier. We are protected from each other, right? So we can transmit information from let's say, from me to you via the second way of transmission, you see? So I described to you the first way of transmission between my own copies of, right? And then there is the second way of transmission between unique matrices, right? And this wave transmission is possible via the calibration of convex copper lenses, you see, via structural codes, you see. So I can exchange information with you only if we share the same structural code, right? Ancestral code, like you see. So you and me share the code, geometrical code, and then we can transmit information between our individual local matrices, so that they don't even intersect, you see? We exist in the parallel dimensions. So it's not just our ancestors exist in the parallel dimension to us, right? We also exist to each other in parallel dimensions, you see? So you exist in your parallel dimension, and I exist in my parallel dimension. We don't intersect, you see? We even see the world differently, you see? And cats and dogs, and forget it, they just exist in a completely different universe. They see it differently even. You see, the small bug, which, you know, crawls on the pool, we are giants for this bug, you see. In Hollywood, they should create a movie about the bug. You see, this is much more interesting than their, this, boo, 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 boo. much more, impressive, you see? So, and transmit information between the bug and me and between you and me, we need to have structural codes. And this is how we transmit information. That's why the fight in the human civilization is going about structural codes, you see? So, which code will be chosen as the communicator, you see? And the codes, they all have this information folded in them, right? So, for example, Magen Dalet, right? Six angel star, right? Does not fulfill the criteria, you see, for this all human, all unity code, because the pyramid is the symbol of hierarchy, right? And it's used as a symbol of hierarchy, right? So it goes to the top, right? And the symbol of hierarchy, slavery, caste system, right? And it is a natural psychotronic weapon because in the pyramid, every signal gets amplified by a resonance, right? If you go to Egypt, go to the pyramid, every sound is getting amplified, like with echo, right? Echo amplifies. So that's why the pyramid, they use the initiation. They put the guy who was going through the initiation, and his heart frequency got amplified by the pyramid. And then it was going to the resonance with this amplified frequency. And this amplified the frequency of his heart, you see? An amplitude was literally increased, and the heart was torn apart, you see? So, pyramid is not good. You see, it's a very dangerous structure, actually, pyramid. It kills bacteria, viruses, birds don't live there, and animals die there. You see, butterflies just drop dead, you see. So, two pyramids together is not a good sign. It's a sign of the fight and hierarchy and unrest, you see. So, Magen David is just by its structural features, you see, it's not good for communication over the entire humanity. It cannot be used as a structural code, okay? So the only structural code that can be used is the code that was used by our ancestors, the solar symbols, the symbol of the sun, of the rotating sun, you see? Because it's the symbol of equality, fraternity, and friendship that has nothing to do with the Nazism. And the attempt to represent it as a Nazi symbol is the attempt to destroy the only symbol that can be used as the structural symbol for the intercommunication of the humankind. Though in the reality, it was used as the symbol of all unity. And it's still used by the billions of people in the East, you see, in the Far East. In Malaysia, in Japan, in China, it's used as a symbol of unity. Because it is structurally the symbol of unity. It means as above, as below. So as above, Baphomet. So like this, it's not a satanic symbol, it's a symbol of our ancestors, which is the symbol as above, as below. Quadrat, crux quadrata, rotating cross, square cross, symmetrical cross, meaning no hierarchy, no slavery, no human sacrifice. Everybody is a god. You see? And Jesus Christ, who is, what is Christ? What this word means? It means Ari. Because Hege is the H. Hege is a Greek. A Hellenistic apostrophe, because we say Hellens, Ellada, and they say Hellens. See, they added apostrophe, you see, comma, and changed the word, but though it's not Hellens, it's Alans, Alane, Alan, Alan, British name Alan, so it's our Russian name. Alane, Rus'at Alan was the country in Middle Ages, early Middle Ages. Ruskalan, or Ruskalan, and Alan is Allah from Allah, light, Allah, light.
Okay, super. We could talk so for many hours, so maybe please say some few words for the wrap-up, for the conclusion.
Okay. Well, what can I say? I think that right now the most important thing is the return to the true history. Because if we return to true history, we understand that we are not Slavs, okay? We are Sak. So Polish people are Sak, Russians are Sak, Germans are Sak, and Anglo-Saks are also Sak. We all Sak. The tribe of the fiery falcon Rarok. Firebird. Phoenix. Finist Jasny Sokol. Phoenix. And we are one nation, okay? So we are one nation, and there is only like 7-10% of us left, you see, on this planet. And it depends upon us whether we survive. And we can survive only together. And if we are gone from this dimension, this planet goes into the stage of the planet of apes. So it will be complete and total degeneration. Because we fight not between nations. We fight with Neanderthals. Neanderthals will be always on this planet because the nature of this dimension consists in the fact that near equator, it's very hard to preserve the structure. You see, the structure of the hologram. So the two torsions get neutralized on the equator. So all these dreams of Peter Thiel, the founder of PayPal and the member of the steering committee of Bilderberg Club to build floating cities near equator, total complete bullshit, okay? So we always will have here people who degenerated to the stage of Neanderthals. And this dimension will be always the fight between humans and Neanderthals. And they made Neanderthals out of themselves. Nobody made them Neanderthals. And any Neanderthal can come back. You see, this is not just like total and complete devastation. They always can come back. So this is the beauty of it, you see? So all Neanderthals can be raised back to the human stage. So we fight not only with them, but we fight for their souls. Because we need to have light in this dimension, you see, access to light. And the more humans we get here on this dimension, the better for each one of them. And if you have too many bestial individuals here, it's worse for us, each one of us. So we are actually interested to raise them up to the higher level, you see? So this is the point. So we're fighting for them. We're fighting for every member of Mossad. So every member of Mossad will understand that they are actually Russian by blood, came from Arya, from the light, and should not become monkeys.
Super. Okay. Thank you a lot for this whole knowledge. Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
Bye bye.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.